If are we if we are alive. Great, we are live. Good evening, everyone. This is Ishan Sharma, and with me today I have a very special guest, Professor S. Irfan Habib. Professor Sayyid Irfan Habib was born in 53. He is an Indian historian and public intellectual. He was a former Abdul Kalam Azad Chair at the National Institute of Educational Planning and Administration. His intellectual collaboration with Dhruv Raina as historians at the National Institute of Science, Technology and Development Studies, New Delhi in the 1990s, culminated in the publication of a series of research articles collected as a volume titled Domesticating Modern Science in 2004 on the cultural redefinition of modern science in colonial India. They also edited a volume together on Joseph Needham, Situating the History of Science in 1999, and the section on science in 20th South and Southeast Asia for Volume 7 of UNESCO's History of Mankind Project, and a reader of Social History of Science in India, Social Science of History in Colonial India in 2007. As an author, his works have been subject to mostly positive critical reception and large scholarship around history of Bhagat Singh and on nationalism. So we are really fortunate to have Professor Habib with us this evening to speak about a very important topic, something that interests Karwan, for something that we have been fighting for, and that is using past as pliable tool for the present. Thank you so much, Professor Habib, for accepting our invitation and for being with us this evening.
Thank you.
Over to you.
Thank you. For us, for me particularly, and for so many other fellow historians, the past few years had been very important, in the sense that history has taken a front seat in our concerns, because it seems that the reputation which history as a subject commanded over the years, not many people actually showed any interest in history. Even as students, lots of young students and in university, in schools, history was not a very, very interesting subject. You know, we had lots of pejoratives about history and geography. But today, history has become an important tool, not to understand the past, but to promote the present. And that is something very interesting, because history has become, like history generally is seen as something to understand the past, formulate the present and build the future. So this is a link between history, present and past, present and future. But all that is now lopsided, because today we are not actually learning from history at all. Many times, if we see, many times we actually want to live in the past. We are not actually living in the present. Some of us are trying to live in the past. And living in the past means that you do not really understand what history is. That is not your interest, because your purpose is to use history as a tool to promote your own political concerns, social concerns, and lots of other things which you probably want to make use of in your present. So in that context, history has become a very, very important subject. The definitions of many many fundamental issues, like the whole definition of nationalism, has been changed. Nationalism has been redefined. We have never understood nationalism the way we understand today. There are lots of things, and I've decided to choose a few instances in this short lecture from the recent past, like things we keep talking about all the time these days. Our stalwarts from freedom struggle like Sardar Patel, like Nehru, like Subhash Chandra Bose, Shahid Bhagat Singh. These are 4 or 5 characters who are discussed, talked about all the time, and for all the bad reasons. First, the general impression which is created by a section which is an empowered section today, which has all the power at its command and all the resources at its command, media included, talks about this past, which is our freedom struggle phase, as if most of these icons which we talk about, which I just mentioned, as if they were all the time fighting against each other and nobody was fighting the British. No? So that is the sort of impression which has been created if you look at the proceedings of the past few years. Not that it has happened for the first time now. It has been an understanding of a section of our people for decades. But today, that understanding has come center stage. That is the understanding of the people who are in power. They are promoting a certain understanding of India, and so for that reason, it is an important development, a very very serious development, which need to be questioned, which need to be understood, which need to be dissected, and elaborated, corrected rather. And I thought I will try to do that a little bit for all of you. History, as we all know, is about the past, as I just said, and how the present allows our past, not necessarily always to better understand the past, but to use the past to legitimize the present. So this is what happens many times, and this is a general understanding, but this understanding very well fits into what is happening in our country today, and that is what I am trying to explain. Now, if you go back to all these debates, and I begin with Sardar Patel, for that matter, Sardar Patel, is generally said that Sardar Patel was actually not in good relationship with Nehru. There are stories being talked about that Sardar Patel actually should have been the first choice, and Gandhi made a wrong choice. And this is very widely debated, discussed, and talked about. What is the relationship of Sardar Patel with the right wing groups today? You know, that also is very wrongly presented and wrongly discussed. The real facts are not really brought into discussion. And I would like to quote Sardar himself. In 1947, on 17 December, Sardar Patel talked about the youth. He said, if they, the youth, follow the path which the Sangh means the RSS, has been, they would be doing a disservice to the country. And this is not my words. You can go back, anybody who has any doubt can go back and check. 17 December 1947, this is a statement of Sardar Patel. He goes to Madras in 1949 and delivers a lecture at in the open grounds, and this is another question, you know, which again discussed and talked about a lot, that Patel actually was not interested in dividing the country, no, and he regretted that why partition actually happened. This is again, you telescope your present into the past, because today your present needs a certain understanding of history. So you want to rewrite or redo or reimagine the past, and imagine the past which actually is convenient for your current political dispensation or understanding. In 1949 in Madras, and I want to quote Patel again, he says, "It is good that we agreed to partition in spite of all its evils. I've never repented my agreeing to partition." Now he talks about Kashmir and the role of Indian Army in fighting the intruders. That also he talks about in that speech, and he very clearly says that my commitment to partition was absolutely fine, and I agree with it. And if you go into history, you clearly find that Patel actually, like Nehru later on, and even Gandhi later on, except for Azad, all of them finally succumbed to the blackmailing of the Muslim League and the British, and Patel was no different. He talks about RSS again. He says, and I'm quoting from the same speech of 1949, these are important because these are few things which are talked about all the time. He says, he's talking about the RSS, he says, change your plans, give up secrecy, eschew communal conflict, respect the constitution of India, show your loyalty to the flag, and make us believe that we can trust your words. To say one thing and to do another is a game which will not do. So this is something which Sardar Patel is trying to explain and talk about RSS. He says that you cannot actually say something to us and go and do something else. So this is something very, very clearly spelt out by Sardar Patel. And he is very, very categorical. So all those, and he's saying this in 1949. And when I talk about this, people say that actually these were views of Sardar Patel in the earlier days. Later on, he changed. Patel actually died in 1950, just next year. So it was less than a year before that he made such comments about RSS. So his views did not really change. These were his views, which remained till the end, till he died. No? So, but he was a dynamic person. You may quote me some other words which he must have used for RSS, but that doesn't mean what I just read out is wrong. So these are also Patel's views. He may have said something positive as well. No? So most of these people who are rich in ideas, who are rich in thought, who are dynamic in their understanding, keep changing their positions. But they, like somebody like Patel, held a view like this in 1949, just a year before he died. He another important thing which we need to understand and talk about is his relationship with Jawaharlal Nehru. That is something which we discuss all the time. My reading of Patel and the way Patel talked about Nehru all the time, at so many occasions, so many letters. Once he went to address a big public rally in Bombay with Jawaharlal Nehru, and an American journalist came and talked to Sardar Patel, interviewed him, and he said, "I'm amazed that such a huge crowd has gathered to listen to you." You know what he responded? Patel said, no, they have not come to listen to me. They have come to listen to Jawaharlal. And they love to listen to him. They come, they gather in large numbers to listen to him, not to me. I have no illusion to accept that people have come to listen to me. So this is an understanding of Sardar Patel about Nehru. And he was not begrudging. He was very happily accepting that Nehru is someone who is popular and That is the reason why Gandhi in 1935 made a statement for the first time, gave a hint for the first time that Nehru is going to be the head or the leader of the government once we get independence. So this is, and Patel refers to it repeatedly in so many other speeches, writings of his. Patel didn't write very much, he generally spoke. But this is the understanding of Sardar Patel with his, about his relationship with Jawaharlal Nehru. Then we come to another icon which is used today and who is again misinterpreted, misread, very conveniently used as a tool for the present, because you need him conveniently to promote your politics of nationalism, because you redefine nationalism where you want to fit in people like Subhash Chandra Bose and Shaheed Bhagat Singh, whom I will talk about later on. Bose, I say it often that Subhash Chandra Bose was not just Indian National Army. It was not just INA. Subhash Chandra Bose was much more than that. No, he did much more than that. He did a lot during 1920s, 1930s. He was a youth leader. He was someone who, along with Nehru, formed Independence League. He traveled all over India, mobilizing youth for the independence of the country. So, and he was actually a socialist. No, he agreed he never declared himself a communist, but he always had a socialist leanings. His forward bloc, which remained part of the left front government in Bengal for so many years, stood for an ideology which was closer to the left and not to the right. So Subhash Chandra Bose, except for the end, when we see his collaboration with the fascists, which Nehru regretted that he shouldn't have done that, because Nehru was a campaigner against fascism, against the threats of fascism. He traveled all over the world, including India, speaking against the threats of fascism and Nazism. And when he sees his dear colleague and friend Subhash Chandra Bose in sympathizing Mussolini and Hitler, he had huge reservations about that, and he has written about it, he has talked about it, he has spoken about it, and these are some differences, but respect for each other continued forever. So the sort of issues which we raise today, the sort of definitions we find for Bose today, those are totally misplaced. They have no place in history. They can have place in the imaginary history because they are not based on facts. This is actually a WhatsApp based history which talks about an imagined past, no, which is not based on facts, which is not based on records. So this is something which you cannot challenge, you cannot question, but you can surely mislead people by circulating these on social media, on WhatsApp, etc., which is happening all the time. And people like us have no way to question that, because those ideas, those misreadings of the past are not based on facts, so you can't even question them. And this happens almost every other day. So Bose, when a party like BJP tries to appropriate Bose, they actually appropriate his unabashed militarism, the INA. No, that is what they appropriate, and this is how that's how they want to pitch Gandhi against him. No? And they do it very smartly. They do not care or deliberately ignore the fact that he was also a self-proclaimed leftist who stood for firmly against the politics of religious identity. Bose was actually mentored by C.R. Das, and we all know what was C.R. Das's politics. So today's understanding of history need to know what actually inspired people like the icons like Bose. Now, Bose did not come up in isolation. He was part of a huge motley of leaders, senior leaders who mentored them. And Bose was mentored by C.R. Das, and we all know what was C.R. Das's politics. Bose never joined the doctrinaire communist ideology, but did speak about his commitment to socialism in his 1935 book, Indian Struggle. And I'm quoting books, so that we don't really question it. Bose describes the hypothetical left-wing revolt within the Congress that would reshape it as a party that will stand for the interests of the masses. That is, of the peasants, of the workers, etc., and not for the vested interests. That is, the landlords, capitalists, and money-lending classes. So this is the politics of Bose. So you need to understand Bose in the context of what he wrote, what he stood for, what was his vision, what sort of independent India he wanted. He didn't want a dictatorship, which BJP generally talks about, or the right wing mostly talk about. This party, and he writes, Bose had no patience. This is another important aspect of his personality. Bose had no patience for communal politics. In the same book, 1935 Indian Struggle, he criticized Hindu Mahasabha and Muslim League, both of them. He called both of them sectarian movements, which were being encouraged by the British to weaken the nationalist forces. So he was very, very clear that why these two, Hindu Mahasabha and Muslim League, are being promoted by the British. They wanted to divide the nationalist forces, and that was very, very clear. And Bose was very categorical. He wrote about it in the Indian Struggle. He spoke about it in so many speeches which he delivered all over the country. Communalism will go, he writes, in Forward Bloc in 1940. He used to bring out this paper, Forward Bloc. In 1940, he wrote, communalism will go only when communal mentality goes. To destroy communalism is therefore the task for all those Indians, Muslims, Hindus, Christians, etc., who have transcended the communal outlook and have developed a genuine nationalist mentality. So for him, a genuine nationalist mentality cannot be communal. So all those people who talk about nationalism in terms of majoritarian ideology, as if religion makes you a nationalist, So that is something which is misplaced. So they need to understand all this from the icons they want to venerate. And I have no issues with anybody who is venerating Subhash Chandra Bose or Bhagat Singh, but try to understand what exactly they stood for, what actually they wanted India to be. They did not want India to be a divisive country where we hate each other. We hate fellow Indians because we belong to different religions, different creeds, different castes. So that is not the India which Subhash Chandra Bose actually wanted. Gandhi and Bose also had serious differences, but they never lost respect for each other. Even after the Tripuri showdown in 1939, Gandhi wrote to Bose that despite our differences, our relationship will not be affected if it is from the heart, as it is from the heart for sure. So this is a letter which Gandhi writes to Bose, and Bose responds to it with equal respect. So these are the relationships which these people had, which are being wrongly interpreted, which are being vulgarized by people who have vested interest in actually projecting, or rather who want to use these icons for their own fitting within their own definition of nationalism and freedom struggle. Their own role, their own participation was marginal, was almost negligible. But the icons who participated, the people who participated, are being used because you need to find space or create a space for yourself within the that respectable group of people who had sacrificed their lives for the country. Now I can talk much more about Bose, Gandhi, and others, but let me move to Subhash Chandra Bose now. Well, to Bhagat Singh, who is again one of the most sought after nationalists, and for the right wing particularly, Bhagat Singh actually fits in very well, because he is the one who commands huge respect all over India, from Kashmir to Kerala, to Kanyakumari, as they say, because he stood for an India which was, and actually, let me also add, he doesn't command respect only in India. He commands respect across the border in Pakistan as well. And this is something very, very significant, because he is the only icon. And our right wing in this country need to know that Bhagat Singh is the only icon in this country who is respected across the border, who is respected in India as well as in Pakistan. There is none else. There is nobody in Pakistan. There is nobody in India. No? All of them have their sectarian identities, sectarian nationalism, unfortunately. It is only Bhagat Singh which is respected by all. Why? Because Bhagat Singh stood for humanity. Bhagat Singh stood for the working class. Bhagat Singh stood for a section which cannot be divided across religious or caste lines or class lines. So he stood for the poor who had no faith, no religion. So somebody like him, who stood for certain vision, obviously commands respect across the border. And I don't know whether you are aware, you know, his birthplace has become a place of pilgrimage in Lalpur, Faisalabad now, in a Banga village, where his house, where he was born, has been converted into a museum, where they have put up all sorts of photos of the family, all sorts of interesting stuff, with whatever they could gather. And they are seeking help from Indians to actually promote it. They have gone even to the court, a section of population, one Mr. Qureshi, who has gone to court to say that hanging Bhagat Singh was a travesty of justice. So all this is happening in a country where no one else is respected except Bhagat Singh. So we are not alone in respecting him. He is respected across. So anybody who wants to talk about him as an icon exclusively of a particular section, right, left, center, whatever, is actually he or she is misplaced. He is someone who is respected across borders, across classes, across boundaries. And reason is that he spoke, he wrote, he left behind an intellectual legacy, a corpus of literature writing on issues like press, the role of press, which is so important even today. And he is writing in 1928, condemning the role of the print media. In those times, there was no other media available, electronic media, etc. And he says that we have riots, we have killings, we have all sorts of things happening in society only because the press has been irresponsible. He writes about caste, against caste, against untouchability, and writes in very strong terms, strong words. So he's someone who is doing this in 1928 at the age of 20, 19. He began writing from the age of 17. So anybody who wants to appropriate him for the present, to promote their own present political concerns, need to understand him, need to see what exactly he stood for. He was not just, you don't celebrate his martyrdom. That is incomplete celebration. You know, we all respect his martyrdom. We should respect his martyrdom. But go beyond that. You know, he stood for certain ideals. You know? So we need to understand him in the context of what he wrote, what he thought, and what sort of India he wanted to build. independent India. So that vision we need to keep in mind. Go and read his Why I'm an Atheist. No, that will give you an idea what sort of young man he was. And that Why I'm an Atheist is not just a harangue against God. No, he talks against God, but he talks of reason. He talks of rationality. He talks of scientific temper. No, he talks against hero worship. And in 1930, he's writing against Gandhi. You know, why people are hero worshipping him. You know, be critical of Gandhi as well. I also respect him, he says. But one need to understand the weaknesses of our leaders as well. We just can't blindly follow. So this is something which some of the leaders today, some of the people today need to understand. Why you should not follow your leader blindly. Try to look at him or look at her in terms of critical appreciation. You know, admire him, but critique him. You know, look at his weaker sides as well. You know, you just can't blindly follow. So these are Bhagat Singh's words. And one need to go and read that to understand. And especially the right wing, which wants to appropriate him, which talks about him all the time, need to understand that Bhagat Singh stood for certain vision, which is actually not easily, not very easy to follow. You need to change yourself. You need to imbibe his ideals, his thoughts. Only then you can be his follower if you want to be. That is what one actually needs, which is not available in the context of what we see all around us all the time. So all these people, for me, people who have left behind ideas like Subhash Chandra Bose, like Bhagat Singh, etc., or even Nehru for that matter, these people are not dead for us. At least they are not dead for me. They are alive in their ideas. They are alive in their work. We actually kill them every day. In history, there are people who actually didn't write very much. So obviously you can venerate their memory, you can respect them as great leaders. But people who have left behind a vision, who have left behind ideas, those people are alive for us. Because they have left behind so much for us to learn and to follow that we don't need to really believe that they are not amongst us. So for us, Bhagat Singh is in the midst of us. Subhash Chandra Bose is in the midst of us because their ideas are still relevant. And I say this with lot of regret that ideas of Subhash Chandra Bose or Bhagat Singh or some of the ideas of Nehru or even Gandhi, they are relevant even today. They shouldn't have been relevant. We should have made them irrelevant. We should have solved all those problems which they raised in their writings. Unfortunately, we have not solved most of those problems. We have not dealt with most of those issues which they raised in the 1920s, 1930s. So they became, they remain relevant even now. So this should not be a matter of pride. It should be a matter of shame that we have not been able to deliver justice to the ideas which they left behind for us. A legacy, intellectual legacy they left behind for us. So in history, there are lots of things which should have become or should become irrelevant if we keep solving those historical tangles, those historical issues. Unfortunately, we don't do, and those historical issues become almost intractable and push us into further mess. I also need to talk to you, besides this political history in brief, about certain things which are happening in our history of science as well, and how history of science is being read, is being understood. And this is again a very popular thing these days, when we claim that we are going to be Vishwa Guru soon and we are going to be teachers of the world, and we make loud claims about all sorts of things. My problem is that we actually, by doing this, we actually do injustice to ourselves. because there are lots of things which India contributed to the world. The whole idea of zero, the whole idea of decimal, there are lots of other things, a few things in medicine, etc. No, lots of things India contributed. But when we make claims which are actually not verified by facts, which are not factual, which are just rhetorical, then it becomes almost a laughable stuff for the world, because we claim all sorts of things. I don't want to repeat all that we have claimed. We have claimed that we had surgery. We used our mythological figures to prove that we had transplantation of body parts, etc. We did all sorts of things. We had aeroplanes flying, etc. No, without even bothering that for an aeroplane technology, you need to have science first. You need to have a text. Technology is something which cannot just come straight away to us. It needs to precede by scientific knowledge, by theory, and those theoretical texts should be available to us. Nothing is available anywhere, and we just talk about it. The point is, and our famous astronomer. Wrote about Jayant Nalikar. Jayant Nalikar, in his little book on popular science, he wrote that actually when we talk about science in ancient India, we go back to mythology, we go back to Shastras. We go back to Ramayana and Mahabharata and Puranas, no? And we don't go back to Aryabhatta or Brahmagupta or Bhaskaracharya or Charak or Sushruta, etc. No? So this is something very strange. You cannot go and talk about science in mythological texts, because they had a different purpose. They were not texts of science. No, it was an imagination of creative imagination of the poet. Of the writer, no, so which we take for reality, no, that is something absolutely absolutely bogus according to Jayant Nalikar, and he's right, and he writes in detail that why we should not do it, no, and this is not happening only with us. It is happening in Islam as well, no, where people talk about Islamic science. There are lots of people who see science in the Quran, in the Hadith, while the Prophet himself says that go and seek knowledge unto China. No, so if Prophet is sending people to seek knowledge in China in 8th, 7th century, so why should people go to China? Because in China there was no Islam. So that means that he wanted people to learn the worldly things, no, the so-called secular science. From anywhere in the world, no, which means you don't have to really seek science in Quran. Quran is not a book of science. Similarly, Vedas and Shastras, they are not actually books of science. They inspire you to seek knowledge. No? These texts inspire you to seek knowledge. No, they don't say that you come and seek knowledge within us, within the texts, within our pages. So that is not, neither the Quran says, nor the Vedas says, nor any other Shastra says. So these are things which we are trying to bring in as legitimate exercise of pursuit of knowledge, which is absolutely bogus, which we need to condemn. There are people have written against it. Mirandanda has written a book about it, 2-3 books actually. I have written about Islam, the practices across the border, particularly the way things are happening over there, the way science is being misinterpreted, misused, and the origins of modern knowledge, modern scientific knowledge particularly, is being projected as Quranic knowledge. So these are things which we are trying to do because we have a very, 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 very unstable present. And in this unstable present, where you actually have nothing much to claim, and you need something to salvage from the past, and that something from the past is actually a misreading of history. No, so this is something which, and in history particularly, and I often use this example, which Professor K.N. Panikkar, our senior historian, once wrote, that history is a subject which is a subject that can be pursued by anybody. No, you don't need to be an expert. There is no method. No, history for people has no method. There is no historical method. There is no historical research. You know, there is no way to conduct historical research. Anybody can come and claim that he or she can do history. You can't do this with economics. You can't do this with sciences. You can't do this with so many other subjects. But you can do this with history. And this is something which is rampant, especially in India or Pakistan for that matter, where anybody can come and make a loud claim about the past or understanding of the past. And in this context, WhatsApp has come in as a very, very, very viable tool. You just create your facts. You don't have to go to archives to actually look for facts. You create facts on WhatsApp, circulate it, make it viral among 3,000, 4,000 people, and becomes a historical fact. And for people like me, it is very difficult to convince that what you have read actually is not history. And somebody comes and tells me, no, there are so many people who have actually shared it. So this is how history is being created. And this is the most dangerous thing which we need to question, that you cannot redo history. You cannot redefine history through imagined facts. No. You cannot use history as a pliable tool to understand what you want to do in your present political concerns, social concerns, or whatever. So history has to remain based on facts, and history cannot become a tool, should not become a tool to promote your political interests. And this is what we are doing today. And unfortunately, there are not many people who are talking about this danger, and we need to understand it not only in terms of university research, historical research. You have to go down to school level. The way at the school level, the subject like history is being taught, or is being designed, recently in the recent past, to be taught in schools. Once you do that, then it is very difficult to reverse. The damage will be irreversible, and that is a danger which we all need to wake up to understand what sort of history we want, what sort of India we want, what sort of India we want to imagine, what sort of past we want. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Abhi, for such an engaging session. And I think there's a quote that is credited to Bhagat Singh, that you might kill me, but they cannot kill. They might kill me, but they cannot kill my ideas, and they can crush my body, but they can not be able to crush my spirit. I think that is very important to understand in today's world that we are living in. And you also mentioned the dangers of democratizing the discipline of history, where history is being rewritten or recomposed in the hands of some people who are politically motivated, and they try to make their point by referring to history. And this is a constant struggle that I think will continue among the scholarship and the people. And I think this is good for the subject, because it really leads to more dialogues on the past.
Of course.
So my question to you, Professor Habib, is, as a historian yourself, and as history students ourselves, how can we fight this battle, and what is our role in this dialogue between popular history and academic history in today's times, in the world of WhatsApp University?
You see, but see, for me, you know, this is a very, 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 very complex and difficult situation. And I have myself tried to cope with it several times. It is not a very easy thing to handle because most of the things which we hear people talk about or write about, most of them are not based on facts. Anything which is not based on facts is very difficult to question. No, it's very very, very difficult to question because you cannot talk about or counter things which are not based on facts. And I don't know how to handle it. You know, I'm at a great loss. The only thing is that we should keep writing. No, we should keep talking. We should keep organizing talks, lectures, and we should keep writing in popular papers. We should keep talking in writing in like papers in Hindi, no, for North India. So the only thing is we need to access people who are interested, no, because there is no other way. No, I just cannot go and hold somebody's neck and say, why are you saying this? Or nobody can do that. So my only way is, the only method is to actually counter it by writing about it, about those facts, against those facts, question those facts. So this is the only way. So young people should do it. No, you should do it in your universities. You should do it in your departments. And you can use people like me. You can use people like so many others to come and talk. And you as young people should talk to each other. That is even better. No, when you read and then share what you read. So that this is the only way, because there is no other way to counter. Social media will keep creating troubles. Social media is very useful, but social media is very damaging as well. You know, so like Twitter is a very decent space, you know, when I joined a few years ago, but now it is not that decent anymore. You know, there are lots of, but still it can be used. You ignore what the rubbish you get, the abuses you get, but you can still share what you believe in, what you write. So it's a useful platform. So that one should continue, and because there's no way to sit back or to be frightened or to be subdued by what is happening around us. You know, that is no way. We need to fight back, and we need to fight back with ideas. There is no other way. And like Bhagat Singh stood for ideas, we need to follow Bhagat Singh in that. You know, ideas are rich, they can't be killed. Yeah. They live on, even if you are gone.
Yes, that's true. We have a question by Soumen Sen Gupta. I'll try to show it on the screen. It is, how did common man foster coherence of Indian history other than being followers of politicians to participate in tryst with destiny?
Mr. Coherence of Indian history other than being... No, I don't know, but why should there is no compulsion. Why should anybody be a follower of a politician? No, you don't have to. No, and tryst with destiny, this is something very different. You know, it belongs to a different period of our history. No, those times since then we have traveled very far, and today I don't think we need to. Not just today, not during the past 7 years, even before that. No, I don't think there is any compulsion for us to follow any leader, because political leaders, that is a choice. You know, if you really feel convinced that somebody has some ideas, somebody is worth following, worth pursuing, there's no harm. One can really be a, and I don't want to be a follower of anybody, because follower means you want to close your eyes. I don't want to follow anyone, and I don't want anybody to follow me. No, you can only learn or unlearn from me or from anybody else. If I have something good to share, and you feel is worth following, do that. You can always critique, you know, I don't agree, fine. So that openness should always be there, that one should be open to a critique. And so I don't know why one should be a follower in any case.
Yeah, and we have questions that I think you have already answered in the session itself, that how history taught us about different shades of single personality. This is by Samrata Sadhu. But government tried to ban the diverse views to a single profit gaining channel. How can we counter that? I think you've talked about that.
Yeah.
And there was this question that Nawabs and kings also used to ask their ministers and quote to write their kind of history, what they liked. So this is also.
Yeah. I mean, these are different times. You know, they were the feudal times, and people wrote history. People wrote actually. There were people who were part of the court, and they had to write something to please their masters. You know, so there were things which were far away from facts. You know, Amir Khusro is a great, great poet and great intellectual figure. A great Sufi, etc. But look at his writings. He also wanted to please Alauddin Khilji. He wrote things which we cannot associate with Amir Khusro at all. But he wrote them. He wrote because he wanted to please his master. You know, he had to do certain things which were not actually, which doesn't fit into his personality at all. Yeah. So I'm giving this one example. There are so many such examples. So such histories were written by people. And another thing, you know, which I forgot to speak about, and which is rampant in today's India, is when we start seeking heroes in the past. We start seeking heroes like in Rana Pratap, in Shivaji, in so many other characters of the historical past. We don't realize that if we seek heroes in the past, in medieval past or ancient past, these heroes will come there with their weaknesses and strengths, because they belong to a different period. They did things which you can't do today. So you cannot actually be, so that's why I'm saying you cannot be a follower of somebody like these names I just spelled out, or so many people who look up to Aurangzeb. You know, what is this? Why should you look up to somebody like him? You know, he may have done something good, but he can't be my hero today. So because we live in 21st century with different values in a democratic world, you know, where such heroes actually have no place. You can respect them. You can find something good in them. There is no harm. That's what history is. You need to learn, but you need to unlearn lots of things. History is not just learning, it is unlearned also. So you have to salvage things which are salvageable. Not everything from the past is salvageable or worth for salvaging. You need to reject lots of things from the past.
There is this one question by Harshvardhan Eluri. His question is, we are being driven into medievalism by creating a hegemonic ideology, especially in Hindi heartland. But even the public are ready to consume and accepting to go back. Is it possible to deconstruct this present hegemony?
No, the only way which I just talked about, the only way to counter any such campaign is to write against it, to question it. That is the only way. Otherwise, you just can't, because what they are doing is talking, speaking, writing all the time. So they should not hog all the limelight. In terms of speaking, in terms of writing, etc. So we all need to do that. That is the only way to challenge them, because nobody can stop them from saying what they want to say. The point is, we need to question them through facts. Whether everybody believes in what we say or not, that is not in our hand, but we need to make attempts to reach out to people in as large a number as possible. That is the only way.
Nancy Sharma asks, that how do we understand history in relation to the cultural amnesia so prevalent in contemporary modern nation states?
Cultural amnesia means in what context?
Nancy, if you can clarify your question, then we can. I think we can take that after. And Soman Sen Gupta makes a comment that history as a proposition must be presented as a falsifiable hypothesis subject to verification, support, and evidence. Most people discard this by clinging to mythology propagated by politicians. This is what I meant to be tenets of followers.
Absolutely. History is not really what the political class peddles. History is based on facts. History is based on so many other ways. Like history has a method, and you need to follow that method. You need to follow that all the tools which are needed to create history. And so I'm sure, Madhav, you cannot believe what the political class peddles. And this is what I'm trying to say. We need to question that. I am not going to believe what is being peddled by the political class, because they know why they are doing it, because it is in their interest to promote a certain history which has no basis in history. There is no basis in facts, which is not based on any sort of record, either literary record, archival record, or archaeological record, or even oral history. A few ways of understanding the past. So these facts actually have no basis anywhere. So we need to question, because any fact which is any historical claim which is made, first of all, the first thing we need to do is question it on the basis of all these four or five things which I just spelled out. It needs to conform to some of these verifiable tools. If it fails in most of these against most of these tools, then that is not history for me.
We'll take one last question if you allow. Professor Abhi. Sure. This is by Somyakanti Bhattacharya. His question is, we need to concern ourselves with not only the pastness of the past, but also the presentness of the past, as said by T.S. Eliot. What aspect of historiography contributes to reading of contemporary texts?
What aspects of historiography contribute to reading? These are, you see, there is no doubt. T.S. Eliot must have made this comment in some context, whatever the context was. But the point is that there are lots of things which we need to understand, which we need to use to understand the contemporary world, the contemporary India or world for that matter. And so surely one of these such quotes actually these are things which don't give you the context why it is being said, why T.S. Eliot actually said it, because I never went into detail. The pastness, of course, Madhav, it has its own value, but why it was said, in what context it was said, that one need to understand, because any statement without context actually has no meaning.
Parul's questions, do you think helping children engage? I think Parul, Professor Habib has already answered that. Yes, we have to engage young people into dialogues, and that is one of the aims of Karwan, and we have been doing that, and I think more students' initiative should come up, and this is the time that they have to come up. They have to engage people with the past, and really as Professor Habib also said, that we have to organize more and more lectures and dialogues on past by professional historians who have done their researches, who have given their life in the research of history and searching about the past. So thank you so much, Professor Habib, for time for delivering this lecture, for engaging with the public. And we really hope to host you again very soon for a lecture.
Anytime.
Thank you so much, sir. And thank you so much, everybody who joined us live on Carvaan. We hope you have a great day ahead.
Thank you.